It's actually really, really hard to find someone who's genuinely created something original. Often we celebrate optimizers, people who've discovered something, refined it, and then made it much better. But that's why John DeMol, to me, is the purest example of original creative disruption. From co-founding his media giant Endemol and then Talpa, he has brought reality TV to become the global phenomenon that we know today. He has redefined the entertainment industry, and in the process, he's also stamped his mark on popular culture for the last 15 years. He is the creative mind behind global hits such as Big Brother, Fear Factor, Deal or No Deal, and the recently Emmy-awarded show The Voice. He is brave, courageous, creative, dedicated, focused, and most importantly, relentlessly original. He faces often a lot of stark criticism. He once said that you can learn more from Big Brother than you can from a book. And when he was labeled the king of trash TV, he said, "I don't really care because I care about my audience, not about the critics." And that's why I'm fascinated to talk to John about how he used his creativity to redefine the entertainment industry as we know it today and for that in the future. John, thank you so much for spending time with us today. We really appreciate it.
You're welcome.
I just first wanted to chat to you about how you've seen the entertainment world change since you and your contemporaries have brought reality TV to the world.
Well, actually, in the year 2000 or 1999, when we launched Big Brother, we sort of created a whole new genre, which has never been there. I think Big Brother was a sort of a front runner to, I don't know, hundreds and hundreds of new formats in the genre reality.
How did the industry react when you were trying to get it made?
As usual, at something really new, the reactions at first are always sort of careful, especially in the bigger markets. I thank God on my knees that I live and work in a country that is much more flexible and much more open to changes than in bigger markets. But even in Holland, they looked at it like, ooh, what is this? Is this gonna work?
What were they anxious about?
They were anxious about the health of the people, the critics, advertisers. Are they willing to put ads in that program? Which indeed, in the beginning, was the fact that they didn't, but then suddenly, when Big Brother was on air in Holland, after 2 or 3 weeks, the whole attitude towards the program changed from negative to extremely positive.
Why was that, do you think?
Well, because I think the preoccupied opinion about the show before anyone has ever seen 1 second of it was so strong. But after 3 or 4 weeks, everybody was sort of falling over each other to adjust their opinion and to admit that Big Brother was great television.
And were there moments when you thought it was going to fail? Because you're starting something so new, you're not optimizing something.
No. My doubts, if any, were more in the technical area, because the first time in the history of television we created a TV show where 120 cameras were individually taping a lot of material. How do we stall it? How do we edit it? How do we do that technically?
And there was, of course, a kind of a social issue as well. I remember you once saying, "Jesus, we need to be careful because otherwise we'll be like God."
Well, actually, if you look back at the first series, Big Brother, to be quite honest, it was so boring. Because we were so careful, because we were so afraid to hurt people, to harm people, that we basically have been watching 100 days, people sitting on a couch talking about baking bread.
Can you remember where the creative idea first came from? Did someone walk in one day, or was it you who suddenly thought, let's try a real life experiment?
It was a coincidence. A guy in my company who was just on a plane said he read in the plane an article about an American project, Biosphere 2. And he was intrigued by it because it was about a group of people put in a big glass bowl, and they had to sort of grow their own vegetables and sort of, you know, live together.
It was a TV show or was it an experiment?
No, it was an experiment. It was a scientific experiment. And I was intrigued, so I kept on asking more and more and more, and that is the whole start of Big Brother.
You know, to me, you do represent the most disruptive creative mind, and I love that. That's why we do this show. Was that something that was inside you from a young age? Did you find that you were breaking rules or trying to do things differently as a younger age, or was it something you found as you got older?
I started working for television for a public broadcaster, mm-hmm. which is state television, actually. Mm-hmm. And that's where I was caught by the disease that television has, because once you start to love it and you love making it, it gets you. And I remember very well when one of my first shows, I was a production assistant. it was a Miss Holland selection.
Like a beauty pageant.
Exactly. That 2 days after the show, I was sitting in a restaurant, and the table next to me was talking about that show. And what I liked so much is that nobody knew that I was involved in any way in that show. But the fact that television has that impact on people, that you bring for a few hours a day some entertainment to people, is something that really got me, and that's my drive.
Now, Holland is a pretty fascinating country because it's small and it's central in Europe, but it has had an impact on the world, probably bigger than its size deserves. And it's not just in conquering the seas and trading goods from around the planet, but the entertainment world has had so many great Dutch producers and Dutch TV shows. What is it about this small but wonderful country that does that?
I think different reasons. First of all, when you live in a small country, you live in a small market, which means that if you want to achieve something, you have to look over the borders already quite soon. If you're born an American, you are born in such a huge market that you don't need another market to become very successful. I have talked to American producers, very successful, who never ever left the country. So, and you don't have to if you don't want to.
Yeah.
If you live in a country with, in those days, 12 million people, and if you get in your car and you drive for 1 hour, you hear a different language, you learn to think more internationally. And I think that's the big advantage of the Dutch entrepreneurial culture we have, is that we have learned to make our money over the borders.
Right.
And don't think local. Secondly, I think the culture in this country is very much internationally oriented.
Variety magazine once called Endemol the unscripted factory, which I think is a bit harsh. It had negative connotations when I read that. Do you get the feeling that reality TV gets the respect that it deserves, or unscripted TV gets the respect?
My first answer is I don't care. and secondly, it depends on who you ask.
Why don't you care?
Well, because millions and millions and millions of people are watching it, are enjoying it. The judgment of that has to do with a generation gap. It's the same discussion as in the 50s when older people disapproved Elvis Presley because it was too sexy and he was shaking his legs and whatever, and young people loved it. And whether an older journalist writes an article about the fact that he doesn't like the show is for me more a reason to push harder than to stop.
What do you think it is about reality TV that makes it so? Why do people love it?
You have so many space in developing new ideas. And because it's a new genre, there hasn't been done a lot yet in that genre. The possibilities are endless. And I'm afraid for all the criticasters of this genre, I have bad news for you, because this genre is here forever.
You did a really interesting crowdsourcing project, Talpa Creative.
Yeah. You know, the idea behind it is that everybody can have a great idea for a TV show. So I thought, when we open the doors for everybody and say, if you have an idea, bring it to us.
Yeah.
And we see if we can do something with it. I underestimated a little bit the response, because I think in a few weeks we got like 20,000
wow
responses.
Were you surprised and delighted, or were you disappointed by what you found?
Well, I was surprised and disappointed at the same time. Because at the end of the day, it didn't bring us that thing that we were looking for, which is the next big thing.
Why is that, do you think?
I don't know. Probably it is more difficult than I thought it was.
Mm. And for people also who have got no experience in the industry.
Exactly.
I'm sure you saw lots of naivety in the creative ideas.
Yeah, but that's no problem, because we are used to that, and we are used to recognizing good ideas, knowing we have still a lot of work to do to finish it to a format, because there's a big, big difference between an idea and a format.
Explain that.
Well, an idea can be four lines. A format is a book that you give to the producer he goes to the studio with to make the show. Every element, every detail, everything should be thought of. In a good format, it can never happen in the studio or wherever you're shooting, that something happens and everybody say, oh, we didn't think of this. What are we going to do now?
And I think in the creative industry, from an advertising perspective, we sometimes forget that. We put so much primacy in the power of an idea, which will be that four lines.
Yeah.
and the craft and thinking it through is equally demanding. Now, your relationships with literature and books is quite intriguing because you've, of course, Big Brother is based off Orwell's 1984 seminal piece of work. And also your upcoming show, Utopia, is based off Thomas More's original piece of literature.
Correct.
Is this intentional? Is this a happy accident? Is this your curious mind that has put
it out? No, it's an happy accident. Because once we had created the format Big Brother, basically the show was called, until three months before we went on air, The Golden Cage.
The Golden Cage.
And only 3 months before we started, someone said, hey, why don't we call it Big Brother? Because in Orwell's 1984, he's describing a world where cameras are watching people and they called it Big Brother. The same with Utopia. The period we're all living in right now, people are worried about the future, people are worried about financial things, people aren't happy with the way things are structured. And that feeling, that attitude, made me decide to come up with a format like Utopia and give 15 people the opportunity to say, okay, if you are not happy with the things they are right now, we give you the opportunity to start all over again, and 15 people can start a new community and a new society with your own rules and your own regulations and see if you can make a better one.
Incredible. So this is a show that's already in production. I know you've launched
already,
it already.
Far in production, and we're going to start it in Holland in first week of January.
Do you, as a business, when you go through the creative process, do you bury yourselves deep in research, deep in data, deep to understand common human trends?
No.
Or is it intuitive?
It is not a mathematical project. You cannot say, if you do this and you do this, the outcome is this. It's not science.
That's a fantastic insight into the creative development. I guess what you're saying is, at some point, you have to take a leap of faith.
Yeah.
You have to go, I intuitively, it feels right.
And you have a little bit of experience and a little bit of a gut feeling, but that's maximum 50%.
Do you think it's still a broadcast medium?
Yeah. Yeah. Both on a social level as on a business level, because it's still the cheapest way for an advertiser to reach a big audience. My main business is free-to-air television. And I still believe that a lot of hours a week, people just want to be entertained and want to sit on the couch with a cup of coffee and enjoy a nice show without pushing buttons or being interactive or having second screens. But I also tend to believe that free-to-air television that comes in everybody's house is a sort of social, cultural connection.
How do you stay plugged into how people are reacting and thinking?
I try to do that by consuming as much as possible information about what's happening in the world. Mm. Because I do believe that even in entertainment, it is a reflection of what's really happening in the world.
In your opinion and your experience, what do you think it is in the DNA of creativity that allows people to be creative? What have you discovered in your amazing career that is the essence to releasing people's own creativity?
Don't be afraid to fail. My people here, I try to teach, say everything loud out you think. And don't be afraid you say something stupid, because in creativity you cannot say stupid things. Be open for everything and try to be original. I think that creativity, and I know that a lot of people disagree with me, but the way we do it here, it's like 80% transpiration and 20% inspiration. It's hard work. It's a systematic way of looking at an idea, bringing it further, and also deciding after 4 months of work that it's not good enough to throw it away.
In our conversation, you have already shared a lot with us. And particularly for me, I took out your very curious mind, but also your ability to take a concept and drive it all the way through to excellence in execution. And sometimes creatively, we forget about that. We forget that the creativity goes all the way through the process. And that's why you've been able to disrupt the entire entertainment industry. Hmm. So thank you so much for your time.
You're welcome.
And it's been extremely great to spend time with you.
It was a pleasure.
Thank you very much.
Okay,
thanks,
bye.
John.
Thanks. Speaking to John was really, really, really interesting. He spots an idea early. He uses his curiosity to understand culture. And then he focuses on delivery. He focuses on getting the creative idea nurtured throughout the entire implementation process. That's what makes creativity really, really, really survive. He doesn't seem to care about adverse criticism. He sees himself as coming up with ideas that people may not recognize or like immediately, but if the viewers respond to them, then that's his real acid test for a great creative idea. Ultimately, I guess he's saying, as an industry, we should stop talking to ourselves and make sure that we are connected to the people to understand whether a creative idea is effective or not. That's what makes his creativity truly disruptive.